Good evening. How are you doing out there in podcast land? Welcome to Living Light, Dark to Dawn, Rock Solid, the place where you come to expand your thinking and elevate your way of being. My name is Dawn Shale, certified life coach and soul healer. How are you all doing? Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you might be listening. If you're listening to the playback, it could be morning by the time you hear this. So welcome. Coming to you from Hunterdon County, New Jersey, as always. And we have Dave, a.k.a. Scooter Bean, is in the house. Welcome, Scooter Bean, Dave. I'm going to just make a couple of announcements before we get started. I'm very excited about tonight's episode. How are you doing? I hope you're doing well. Carrie and maybe Frank and who else is going to come strolling into the live studio this morning. This is going to be a fired up one. I'm very excited about this. I'm actually quite excited today. Oh my goodness. So we had snow here in the great state of New Jersey, Hunterdon County again, as I already said. And here's, oh my goodness. It was a winter wonderland this morning, 5 o'clock this morning, about, no, it was like 10 to five this morning. We lost power. And how I knew this, I have this levitating moon over on a, you know, in my bedroom. And when the power goes out, which it has a couple of times over the winter, I think this is the third time we've lost power. And it's not for like days on end. It's just for a couple hours. I don't know. It's frustrating, but what are you going to do? So, and twice it was when I was sleeping. Once the first time it was when I was sleeping. When I was going to sleep, I think. Like that was when I go, when I was, it was like maybe midnight. Anyway, I'm sitting here thinking about this. Let's keep moving. We don't want dead air. So anyway, the moon levitates on this electromagnetic field thing, which is really awesome. So it fell and it startled me and woke me up. I'm like, okay, I looked at the clock. It's 10 to five. I'm like, okay, not time for me to get up yet. I'm going to go back to sleep. Whatever it does, it does. And I just really wasn't moved by it. I wasn't going to allow myself to be moved by it. You know, it's like, what are you going to do? You can't control these things. So I got up this morning and I knew we were having snow. I prepared for it. I covered my car with my, my car cover, which is amazing. And, you know, looked out the window and sure enough, it was like blizzard-like conditions. I mean, it was blizzard-like conditions. So I finally got up for the day. I got up and there's no power. There's nothing, you know, and there's no water. You can't, it's a septic here. Well water. So you can't use the water. You can't flush the toilet. I mean, you can flush the toilet once, but eventually it's all going to stop. So it's better that you don't. And the gas stove did work, however. So of course, you know, I got my tea. I have a tea kettle. I usually use this electric tea machine. I might call it a tea. It's not really, it's a hot water, electric hot water heater thing. And you just push the thing and it boils. I love that machine, but I have the tea kettle as a backup now in the event that there is in fact, because you can light the gas stove. Thank God for gas stoves. I can't stand electric stoves, but you light it with the lighter. And so I was able to make hot breakfast and move on with the day. And man, it was coming down. It was a winter wonderland out there and it was heavy snow, heavy, dense snow where all of just the branches were leaning over, branches that don't normally lean over. And I'm looking out and I'm like, wow, what's that over there? You know, it's just real heavy. And at the same time, while it was coming down, it was wet. It was unusual. I mean, snow is wet, of course, but it's usually like frozen. This was kind of, it was packing heavy snow, but drippy, very strange. So in any case, that's probably why we had the power outage, because when the heavy snow, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you know, branches, trees lean on power lines, whatever. And that's, so they fixed it. It came on by 8:30 in the morning. So that was good. You know, thank God I'm home like this and I'm able to adjust. But so anyway, yeah. And so by the late afternoon, it had all melted off the trees. Everything's dripping. I did clear the car off with, you know, you just yank on a little more of a yank. I had to tug really hard because it was so heavy, but the snow just falls right off. It's a great thing. If you don't have garage access, I highly recommend you get one of these. It's amazing. I mean, it really, you just pull it off. It's, your car isn't even wet. Sometimes it's a little wet or something, but it's amazing. These car covers, $30 or $40 on Amazon. It's really worth it because I have an SUV. It's no fun trying to shovel snow off the top of that. It's awful. It's horrible. And it's supposed to be illegal. You can't, you know, you're not supposed to drive around and be spreading snow all over the place, because when you drive, it's like it can obstruct the person behind you. It could ultimately cause an accident. It's not supposed to be legal, but anyway. So melted, not in the grass, like on the, but this, the sidewalks are clear. This, all the streets were clear. There's no, it's just dripping. It's a totally different day. This clouds disappeared. The sky cleared up. The sun came out. It's like, wow, we just had, we had like just this blizzard. Within a half a day, it turned back into spring, kind of, sort of. Carrie's in the house. Hey, Carrie, how are you? Yay. Two very loyal listeners are here. Carrie and Dave. Maybe Frank will show up. I'm not sure. I saw his activity a little bit. Maybe he will. We'll see. Really good topic tonight. I'm very excited. Just covering, the little announcements that I do and banter about the weather a little bit. And I just shared about the winter wonderland we had here this morning and how it's gone. And the daffodils started blooming in January, last month. They started blooming. We had a snowstorm that covered those, and we thought, these sprouts are going to die. And sure enough, the snow melted, and they did, just kept right on growing. So they're like 5 or 6 inches high now. So now they've been under snow. We're going to see what happens. But there's so much I could talk about that, but there's something about these plants, about this bulb, about this living organism that just has a, I don't know what word to use, that it's, no matter what, it's just going to keep right on growing. They won't bloom officially probably until like late March. I don't know how this is all going to work, but they're not going to die. I just know it. And so just very cool. So I shared some pictures of that today. Shout out to Margie Pargie, Ms. Bet, and of course New Jersey. New Jersey is always in the top spot in the downloads. The downloads are going up. I think I've gotten another 200 downloads since last week. I only did one last week, last Tuesday. Haven't done one since then. Thursday I took off. Today's Tuesday, of course, and then Thursday I do believe I'm going to have a special guest. So until otherwise notified, I do believe I'm going to be back this Thursday with a special guest. So I'm excited about that. And so yes, so a shout out to Margie, Jersey girl, Ms. Bet in Wisconsin. And always got to give the shout outs to loyal listeners and people that really pay attention and listen. Always appreciated. So, how is everybody doing? How's everybody doing? One last announcement. David Medanski, author of the brand, the book, the man, the legend, David Medanski, Jaded Health, of course, is the brand, the book. It's just amazing. And it looks like I probably am going to be going back down to Dallas the end of April. Plans have not been sealed yet. Flights are not booked just yet, but it looks like I'm going to be doing that for season two. I'm excited about that. If you are looking to be healthier, leaner, lighter, just all around feel better about yourself, and it's not about how you look, although when you know what they say, that it's better to look good than to feel good. No, that's not true. So check him out, David Medanski, Jaded Health. He's been on my show a couple of times, and actually he is going to be my guest on Thursday. I could not keep it to myself, so he's going to be my guest. We're going to talk about Jaded Health. We're going to talk about all these things, and it's going to be fresh content. So do tune in to listen to he and I chat. It's going to be good. But do check him out. I believe Carrie bought his book, and he's just an amazing human being, husband, father, the whole ball of wax, just a great guy. And he walks the talk. And he exemplifies and demonstrates everything he talks about. And you want to just, check him out. Jadedhealth.com, I believe. If I'm wrong, I apologize. I should know this by now. The show that we filmed in Dallas in October has been out since January 18th. It's on the it's noted in Instagram, my Instagram page, and it's also still pinned at the top of my page in Facebook. And probably just easier to go to my Facebook page, Dawn Shale, real simple, and just look at the pinned post at the top of my page and just click on it and push play if you want to hear this. It was an interview with him on his show, Jaded Health, discussing everything that I do, what I'm about, why I do what I do. It was only a half hour, so I could only share so much in a half hour. I pretty much covered the hot topics and the hot points as best as I could. So season two is going to be different. We're going to get into a different conversation. It's going to be good. I'm looking forward to it. But check him out, Dave Medansky. So how is everybody doing again? Tonight's topic, energetic relating and communicating. Energetic relating and communicating, people. And I did forget, today is February 13th. I want to mention this just for a quick minute. You know what tomorrow is, Valentine's Day. Well, it's Valentine's Day on the calendar, you know, and this is the third year, you know, we celebrated that last week. I mentioned that it's the third anniversary of this podcast has passed. And I've mentioned Valentine's Day the past 2 years, and I don't hate Valentine's Day. I'm just not fond of the dynamics that surround Valentine's Day. And I think that if you want to celebrate Valentine's Day, please do have a ball, have a blast if you're celebrating love, because love is who you truly are. Anyway, it should be 24/7 love, 365, you know, because love is who we are. And the thing that I don't like about Valentine's Day is all the different things that take place with thousands of people, you know, and it's usually the men feel obligated to get the women something, and the women, there are tons of women that are like this. They expect to get something. They don't feel loved if they don't get something. They feel, well, if you really love me, let's see what he's going to do for Valentine's Day. And it's low vibration. It's low energy. It's just all low things that surrounds a date on the calendar, which it's not even a holiday. I was going to look it up today to see what the origin was. And I just said, you know, I'm not going to waste time on this. What was the origin of Valentine's Day? And people do respect and observe it for extra love, for just to celebrate love in general. And that's great. And if you want to do that, that's great. But having to get the dozen roses, the two dozen roses, the flowers sent to the house, to the office, whatever it is, you know, and I remember I worked in corporate for 5 years, and every time Valentine's Day rolled around and some girls got stuff and others didn't. And it was just this petty kind of stuff. You know, it still exists today. It really does. So that's why I don't like Valentine's Day, because I have probably said this for decades. If Valentine's Day happens to fall on my grocery shopping day, sure enough, I'm in the grocery store, I don't know, between 2 and 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and in come the men at the last minute running into that refrigerator to get, you know, the floral department to pick up their flowers in a card real fast to run it home because they're working and they're busy and stuff like this. And so I would rather have flowers on August 10th from somebody. That's what I would rather have. I would rather have someone send me flowers to my home or a card or some nice gesture, you know, in the middle of June, you know, instead of Valentine's Day. It's cliche. It's kind of, you know, so anyway, if you're going to celebrate it, have fun and enjoy it. But otherwise, you know, I'm not crazy about it, because you are love at your core all 24/7, you know? So for those of us who are love bombers all the time, for those of us who love on the regular daily, we're always talking about it. We're talking about ascension and multi-dimensional, the multiverse and all these different things. And you know, the higher love and the conscious love, it's, you know, we're kind of like, all right, can we just get past this? And I'm glad it's on a Wednesday. I'm glad because when it's on a Friday or a Saturday, they call it Valentine's weekend. I'm like, what? It's not Valentine's weekend. Okay. It's not Valentine's weekend. So tomorrow's Wednesday. It's in the middle of the week. You couldn't celebrate it over the weekend, and you're certainly not going to drag it onto this weekend. So there's that. There's that, people. Just love all day long. Love the one you're with, you know? And if you can't be with the one you love, don't be with anybody at all, because you're just using them. Okay? So let's move on. Energetic relating and communicating. Why am I talking about this? Yes. So Carrie said anytime, just because. Yes, just because. Not because it's the February 14th. It's the just because it feels authentic. It feels real. It's authentic. It's that's what it's all about, my friend. So Carrie, you'll meet the woman. I'm telling you, just, you know what? Get your ass to Texas first. That's where it's going to happen. Maybe. I don't know. That's what I think. I think if you get to Texas and you get there and then everything falls into place, then you're going to meet the woman. I don't know. I'm just, that's just my opinion. I'm just saying that could possibly be it, but I wish the best for you. It'll happen. It will. Just hang in there. So, all right. So why am I talking about energetic relating and communicating? Well, I believe it was last week that I talked about communication last week, and Miss Tina Hammond has re-entered the live studio. There's my girl. Is that thing, are the cheering, is the crowd skipping? I mean, how dare them? Is that what they're doing? How you doing, my friend? So Tina's back. I'm so glad. This is, it's a sort of a spinoff on what I talked about last week on communication, but this is an energetic, relational, and it's different. There's fresh content here. I'm not repeating what I said. So Carrie just said, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, I think so. Me too. So I'm in agreement with you on that. So it's sort of a spinoff of what I talked about. It's not really part two, because this is, there's a whole heck of a lot of shaking going on for those of you that are the empaths, the seers, the highly sensitive people. You're none of this. You don't label yourself. You're just very observant. You're an observant person. There's a whole heck of a lot of things going on, especially in relationships, and things are shifting and shaking up and changing and moving. And the reason being is because, first and foremost, we are moving into a deeper space of love. I say this all of the time. I've been saying this for 3 years since the inception of this podcast. And the more we move into deeper love, well, what that's all inclusive to character, communication, relating, you know, healthier boundaries, higher standards, you know, and it doesn't mean standards of which you think you're too good for someone or that someone's not good enough for you. It has nothing to do with that, but it has everything to do with detaching from the codependent system that we've been attached to, you know, shedding, lies and things that we've believed, things that haven't served us, realizing more and more how worthy we are, how valuable we are, what we bring to the table. And it's just, we're just moving into this deeper consciousness of, you know, I really am awesome. You know, you really are amazing. And you really should not put up with that friend who only wants to talk to you when it's good for you or when it's good for them. And I'm talking about, this has been going on for years. You've been in a relationship, a very one-sided relationship, men, women, two gals, two guys, whatever it is. People are coming into this realization because you're on this personal development journey. You're on this ascension journey. You're moving into this higher consciousness. And so with that, it's like, wow, the light's going off. It's getting brighter. You're moving up higher. You're like, wow. So this is what I really want. I want this out of life. I want these kinds of friends. I want this kind of a circle. I want this kind of a tribe. I want this kind of a job. This is how much money I want to make. Like, you're really coming into total clarity of, you know, and it doesn't, people have had jobs for a very long time and they've made their paycheck, but they haven't been fulfilled. They haven't had a sense of real satisfaction. So if you look at any area of life right now, it's all shifting. All of it is shifting and changing to your highest good. To your highest good and to what serves your soul and why your soul is here, instead of settling and putting up with all of these half-assed relationships and half-assed situations and, you know, half-assed, you know, you don't do anything half-assed. You know, if you're going to go all in, go in with your whole entire ass. You know, you can't, don't do anything half-assed. I mean, it's like, so two cheeks, baby, both cheeks all in. So I'm talking about this because all of a sudden, you know, have you ever been in a space where you realize, wow, this person's been behaving this way, like, okay. And you have to establish a boundary now, or suddenly you want to raise your standard up a notch. How do you do this? How do you handle this? You have to be honest. It's communication, having a conversation. Healthy people can handle questions. Healthy people can handle questions and they can handle conversations. And so how this sort of started since last Tuesday is a friend of mine, wrote to me, a lady friend. I've been Facebook friends with her for a while. We've talked on the phone a few times. And I don't know if I wrote to her. I think I wrote to her. I don't know what it is. It goes on and off. And she's great. I love her. And so I think I reached out to her. We send each other hearts, you know, we find like, you know, and today, by the way, I was making my salad and I have these mild pepper ring things that are in the juice, you know, in the jar. And I wanted to throw a couple of peppers in and I just took the peppers out of a jar and I put one down. And sure enough, this pepper was round and it had it looked like a cookie cutout, like a cookie cutter. It had a heart, perfect heart shape right in the center of it. It's like, there we go. You know, that's what I'm talking about. That's the energy. I mean, you know, when you're connected to yourself and you are, I've been seeing hearts for years everywhere, whether it's heart shaped rocks, leaves, whatever. I mean, fuzz on the ground. When I worked in a barbershop, once there was a tuft of hair, after I did a haircut, there was a tuft of hair that actually landed in the shape of a heart on the ground. I would bring my lunch to work. And one time, like the piece of turkey had a heart cut out in it. I mean, like all kinds of things. So it's like things and beings and stuff is just mirroring back to you. The love energy that you are connected to is going to show up all around you. And that's another reason why I'm not crazy about Valentine's Day, because Valentine's Day is about gifts and material things. It's the buying the flowers and the buying the going out to dinner. And I got to take her out. Wow. No, you don't gotta. And if you gotta, I don't wanna. So, you know, your energy is going to create this love all around you. And it doesn't mean you're in a good mood every single day, especially if you're going through things and you're processing things. You know, and this journey of growth is, you know, it's not about feeling good every single moment of every single day. It's about your intention. It's about you're on a growth journey. And some growth spurts are really hard, like really, really hard. And as long as you are wanting to move in that direction, it's going to be mirrored back to you that way. It's going to be mirrored back to you. You're going to see this like, okay, you're doing well. You're on the right track. Here's where you're at. I'm with you. So, oh, gee, Dawn, it was a pepper out of a jar. You're damn right. Absolutely. I picked that pepper. Peter Piper picked a peck of, you know, I picked a heart-shaped pepper out of my jar today. So there's that. I mean, look, everything is energy and things show up just at the right time that you needed to. And, you know, so getting back to people communicating, it's not even just about two people communicating. It's just about the whole, you know, space and energy of love that we're moving into. And it's going to shake loose the things that don't belong, or it's going to shake loose the things that don't want to develop and expand into that space of love. And it's hard. It's tough. It's a tough space when, you know, you're wanting to move forward and you're wanting to just expand and you want everything that you can get in this loving space and other people don't, or they don't know how, or they don't see it yet. And you can have conversation, and I'm not contradicting myself, but I'm saying that sometimes it gets to a point like you're kind of like the things you had in common, you're not having in common. And for me personally, this is the way it's been. You know, I know people that I'm connected to, and I know where they kind of all belong, so to speak. And it's not, and I'm not saying this from a shame or judgment space at all. This is not said from any shame or judgment. It's just said from a space of health, you know, a healthy space and just my way of being is that, I want total and complete health, wealth, and abundance to be applied to every nook and cranny of my life. Does it mean that it's actually manifesting in this moment in every nook and cranny of my life? Not necessarily, but that's what I desire. That's what I'm moving towards. And this is what a lot of us, let's say, the love bombers, I call them, or the love pursuers, or and whatever falls under that umbrella, this is where we are headed. And so we're going to be not settling for some things anymore. We're not going to be wanting to tolerate some things anymore. And so I can only spend a certain amount of time with maybe some people, because whether it's on the phone, whatever it might be, because, you know, I understand that everybody's in different phases of consciousness, and they certainly are, But what happens is if you keep subjecting yourself, no matter who it is, if you're dating a woman or you're dating a man, or you have a male friend or a lady friend or whatever it all is, a girlfriend, a boyfriend, a sisterhood or a brotherhood. And, you know, every time you talk to them or get together, it's all this negative stuff, or it's all of this, you know, maybe it's not all negative, but it's just, there's just certain things that, they can't support you in, or they don't even support themselves in. You have to draw the line somewhere. You have to just have healthy boundaries, and maybe you can just limit yourself to certain, like, you love this person. It's not making them wrong. It's not making you better. It's not making them worse. It's not deeming you right. It's not deeming them wrong. It's just about, you know, the vibration and the consciousness of that. You can't subject yourself to so much negativity because you love someone, and that it's eventually going to rub off on you, and it'll tear you down. It really will. Eventually. Well, I'm strong enough for this. Yeah, I told myself that many times over and over again in different situations, and I lost every single time. So here's the thing. So I'm talking about questions. I'm just going to go with this. I notice nuances, especially energetically. Okay. And if you're highly energetically wired, of where you detect vibes, you detect energy, you can tell there's been a difference or a shift here or there. And these memes go all over social media all the time. But if you're the kind of person you can detect this, you know, you should be able to ask anybody, hey, are you okay? What's going on? What's up? You know, I'm sensing a little bit of a difference, or something's off a little bit, or whatever. Anyone that values the connection and the friendship or the relationship, whatever that might be, in whatever context it is, should be able to handle that. And you should be able to handle that as well. You know, if someone comes to you and says, hey, you know, I have to tell you something, or I want to ask you something, it's in the space of questions. When, you know, that whole, we have to talk, you know, especially there's this old, what is it called? You know, that, and it's out there still, that when a woman says to a man and they're in a relationship, you know, we have to talk, you know, the man freaks out and the woman's like, and then there's this whole, what is the word? I'm trying to think of the word, not dynamic. There's right on the tip of my tongue, but there's just, I'm going to say dynamic, but there's this whole dynamic surrounding all of that, you know, and usually because the women are more emotionally connected and men are typically maybe not. But in the higher consciousness space where men are conscious, women are conscious, it takes on a whole, it's totally different dynamic. But so, you know, talking is not a four-letter word. Confrontation is not a four-letter word. It's not a bad thing. And I know that I've talked about this before, but it's so very necessary in this moment because of the shaking and because of the things that are happening, the shifts and the changes and all this stuff of where we are, you know, this universal shift. People have ignored this for so long. You know, they've ignored it forever. They don't think that communication is, oh, I don't, communication, I don't want to listen to this, I don't want to know about this. So then you argue with your wife, you argue with your husband, you argue with people at work, you argue with your friend over the phone, you never resolve anything. And then the stuff is thrown under the rug and or under the whatever. And then what happens is the next, you let it go. And then the next situation arises. And what happens the next time? Something else arises. And then you drudge up what happened the time before and the time before that. And then you're fighting about four things at once. I mean, it's just, it's not healthy. It's toxic, really. And we have to get a grasp on being able to handle questions. You know, just because someone asks you a question, it's not an invitation to an argument or a fight. It's a question. And when you're grounded and healthy within yourself, you can handle questions, whether it's me, whether it's you. We can handle questions. We can handle the questions of, Because you're secure, you're safe and secure on who you are, and you know what your intention is, and you know where you are, where your stance and position is with that particular individual. And healthy people want to work things out. They want to have conversations. They want to clear up a misunderstanding. Sometimes there's just stupid little misunderstandings. The majority of people can't even handle the stupid little misunderstandings. It's called making, you know, mountains out of molehills. So what starts out as a molehill, you know, we can't handle this. And the reason being is because there's old debris, there's wounds, there's garbage, there's stuff from the past that has never been cleared. And so someone asks you a question, it's like, oh my God, you know, the alarm goes off and, you know, everything is just this huge, massive thing is happening in this person's head. Oh my God, somebody asked me a question. And they're like flailing, all emotionally flailing over this. You know, that stuff is over. It is time to clear that. Really clear it. If you want better friends, if you want a man in your life, if you want a woman in your life, if you want to advance relationally because life is people, as long as we're here on this planet. And I understand the multiverse and all these things that I talked about last Tuesday. And if you want to sort of maybe understand what the spinoff here is, listen to last Tuesday's podcast and it'll kind of bridge the gap to this and it'll make more sense. It's over. You know, that stuff is over. This dysfunctional stuff is over. It has to be done because in order for us in the collective, for people to experience healing and for people to experience what you really want in life, it comes through people. Everything comes through people. Everything does. No man is an island. You can't be an island. I mean, if you have a job that you can work from home and you never have to leave the house, and you only have to report to your boss maybe once a week, and maybe you have your mid-year review or whatever it is, and you don't want to be social and you're antisocial, okay, fine. You can be an island if you want. And I actually knew a guy like this back in the early 2002 and 2003. Oh my gosh, his favorite song was "I'm a Rock, I'm an Island" by I don't know who the heck it was. And it just he used to brag about this. It's like, you want me as a girlfriend, but okay, you're a rock and you're an island. Not on my watch. I mean, you can't be an island and have a woman in your life at the same time. You can't be, women, this applies to everybody. You can't be so closed down and unto yourself and such a rock and such an island unto yourself that you don't open up, because emotional intimacy, and that's one of the talking points. And you know, I just dove right in here. I didn't even mention what the talking points are, which I normally don't do. Consider this the introduction and it's a spinoff. I'm not talking about the first talking point, which is questions. What are the rest of them? People about humanity, confrontation versus productive communication, love withheld, intimacy compromised, withdrawing, punishment, and boundaries. That's a tough one. Emotional splicing as mixed feelings. That's going to be a good one. Emotional splicing. That one came to me this morning. The energy you house and demonstrate, and so much more. So those are the talking points. So when people are really about humanity, okay, and this goes for all the people here's what the story that I was starting to tell you, and I'm just flying by the heart, the seat of my pants, and the heart space here tonight. Like I normally do that anyway. Simon and Garfunkel. Thank you, Dave. So this friend of mine that I know on Facebook wrote to me, or we were having an exchange. It doesn't matter who started what. So we had this exchange and they confided in me that they had a surprise projected attack from a close friend. And they said seemingly out of nowhere. And they said it shocked me all the way down. You know, it shocked the daylights out of her. You know, and she proceeded to say things I'm not going to, you know, say with personal stuff. Not that anybody would ever guess who this person is. It really doesn't matter. I'm still a very, you know, confident person. So I was like, this is my specialty. Relationships has always been. Communication has always been my specialty, and relating with people has always been. And I did not learn this from anybody. It's just been something that I came here, my soul came here, and my soul knows communication. My soul understands relationships. Somehow it just does. So we had this exchange and my response, you know, she did say, it looks like there's some spring cleaning. And, you know, it's not just about spring cleaning. And so I wrote to her a whole bunch of stuff. And I said, there's a shit ton of flaky spirituality out there and statements endorsing it. But meanwhile, when it comes down to truly relating with each other, when conflict or disagreement hits, which is human and bound to happen, people bail. Most people have not been taught how to. They were raised in an environment of fight or flight, or both. So the super cosmic ones, bless and release, cut off, or ghost. It's toxic as you know what. I don't care how one spins warm and fuzzy vibes around it. Love is the very reason why we can talk through a disagreement or mutual understanding in is the arena where growth takes place more than a yoga mat. And then I said, life is people. And I continued, I went on and on for a while. I was like, wow, this is really long. And they wrote back and they said, you know, you should post everything you just wrote. It's not just common sense gold. It's not flakes of gold or fool's gold, but this is like the real deal, mind deep into soul, 24 karat kind of gold. I love her dearly. And I was going to post it. This was going to be my post today because I knew I was talking about this tonight. And I didn't because the power was out. And I just felt like I'm going to post what I'm going to post this morning. It would have taken me too long to put it together. And I knew I was going to do the podcast anyway. So here we are. So this is where, you know, and there's a shit ton of flaky spirituality out there. And it's like, you could talk about love and you could teach about quantum and cosmic and mystic and insight and astral and all these things. And you can teach about all this stuff all day long and you can be about it all day long. But if you don't know how to have a conversation and you can't handle questions and you can't ask questions, what good is this? Because this is love is surrounding all of this. Love surrounds all of this. And so people that are really about humanity, okay, and this happens in just people's lives, in their business and in social media, that they want to teach and they want to do certain things. And this is kind of important. This is an important one. I gotta write this down. A measure of understanding. So here's where I got into the real juice of what I responded to this person. And I'm going to go back and read this. So here's what happens. Okay. And I'm not slamming spirituality. I'm slamming the flaky side of spirituality, all the flaky stuff that goes on, that it's all about this woo-woo, super multi, this, that, and the other, but we can't have a conversation. You can't, because conversation is connection. That's the emotional into me see when you can connect. That's how we connect via conversation. It's not all telepathy. I mentioned this last week. I mean, I'll say like, and Tina knows this, and, you know, I'll think of people that, you know, somebody will be on my heart. It's like, I'll reach out to them. Hey, how you doing? What's going on? And it'll turns out, wow, you couldn't have reached out to me in any better timing than now. Or sometimes I'll even have a word for someone or maybe just an encouragement or whatever it is. That is a level of telepathy, but having full blown conversations, you know, it's just not happening in this moment. And I said this last week, the balance, it's about balance. So here's the thing. So here's what happens that I said to her is that in this journey to love, right, your healing journey, even in your fitness journey, whatever it is, to deeper consciousness and deeper love, people, this is what happens, that people get a measure of healing. They'll get a measure of healing. They'll get a measure of understanding. I got to write this down because something else just came to me that I forgot to include into the... I'm really not trying to get on your nerves. Piggybacking energy drives me nuts. So I just wrote that down because it just popped into my head. So here's what I said. I got to find this. And what I wrote to her. I want to read it exactly how I wrote it. So, well, I'll just do the best I can to explain it. So what happens is people get a measure. They get a portion of healing. They get just enough to feel better than they did before. Have you experienced that, or do you know anybody that's experienced that? That they're living like in a particular, you know, state for so long, and then they get a breakthrough, and they get a portion of healing, and they get a portion of it enough that they feel a little bit better than they used to. They have some confidence. They've obtained some, you know, some light, some of their light. And so now what do? They get it just enough to feel better. And then but then what happens is they'll find a modality, a gift, or something to now become a teacher of, like astrology, tarot, Reiki, meditation. And by no means like Tina here, she is a tarot reader. She's awesome at what she does. So this is at no way, shape, or form reference to her. So this is no reference to her. But other people out there, this is what they do. So now all of a sudden, I have this breakthrough. I have this understanding. I feel, oh, I'm healed and I feel so much better. So now I'm going to find this, that, or the other. Oh, Light Bright's here. Hi, Light Bright. How are you? Glad that you're back. So now they're going to, I'm going to do this now. I'm a healer now. Or I'm going to be an astrology reader now, and I'm going to do this, or I'm going to do that, or I'm going to be a yoga teacher, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to teach all this stuff. And in the meantime, and it's not about perfection. It's about whole. It's about becoming whole enough. And I'm going to talk this through. So it's not about the perfection thing. And so what happens is now the self and identity gets wrapped around these modalities. The self and the identity gets wrapped around the tarot, gets wrapped around the astrology, gets wrapped around the yoga, gets wrapped around the meditation singing bowls, gets wrapped around, you know, maybe it's a book club. It gets wrapped around that. Maybe it's a Facebook group you've created. So now you're wrapping your identity around that. And that's now become your identity. And you're not seeing the healing all the way through, like all the way through. And I'm talking about the snots on the rug that you have done the work. Like, well, is it possible to do the work because nobody's perfect? I'll tell you how this results. It's not about being perfect, and you can do the most of your real traumatic wounded work when you can relate to people. That's how it shows up. That's how it shows up. Healing and wholeness shows up in how you relate. So this is a sort of a circle, how this works. But so this person's sharing with me that a dear friend of theirs slammed them out of nowhere. And, you know, I wrote all of this back to her, and I said, and because I had a feeling who this might be. And I know her, this particular friend, she is on a quest for, she wants love to the core of her being. I know that about her. And it happens in stages and phases. And she's a mom, and she's an amazing mother. And there's nothing wrong with wanting to be involved with these modalities. There's nothing wrong with any of this. I mean, you could even attribute this to pastors in a church, pastors' wives, teachers, ministers, whatever. And because you've experienced a portion of this. And so what happens is, okay, well, now I'm running on the high of this, you know, I'm running on this high of this portion of healing that I've gotten, but I get triggered over here with people. I get triggered over here with these questions. I get triggered over here with this, that, and the other. I still experience insecurity. That was the other one. Insecurity. Insecurity is a massive, massive, massive one. It's massive. Hard for women. And the older you get, the harder it is, because there's pride and all kinds of stuff involved in this. I mean, it's hard for men too. It's hard. I mean, once you're out of your 30s, you know, insecurity is no fun to drag through your 40s and into your 50s. And now you're like 60s upwards of 70 and you're still insecure. Like, that's really tough, because now there's a rock solid shell of pride that's covering that shit. And you just, it's like, you're not going to admit it. Well, I'm 65 years old. I'm 70 years old. I'm fine. They're wrong. She's wrong. I don't want to hash this out. I don't want to have these conversations. I don't want to be triggered in this insecurity that I'm 70 years old, but I really don't want to face it. You know what? You're shooting yourself in the foot. You're depriving yourself. And here's the thing. Here's what I said a long time ago. I had a client a couple years ago with this sort of a thing. And they were up in age, and a paying client. And it was, you know, I could see right through this. That's my job. And that's what I do. And I wanted to help this person with all my heart. And I could tell that they're like, you know, they just wanted me to tell them that they were okay. It's like, my job isn't to tell you you're okay. My job is to guide you to where you need healing and clearing. So you can then sort of, if you want to call it okay, I'm not here to stroke your ego. I'm not here to make you feel better about yourself. I'm here to guide you into the truth of who you are, so then you can feel better about yourself on your own, and you don't need anybody to tell you this. And seriously. So it's the portion of the healing. And so now we want to teach. Well, this person, and I can do this too. And it takes on this sort of, you know, I can do this and this is what I'm meant to do. And I mean, look, I knew 25 years ago, I was meant to do what I'm doing now. I wasn't in a place 25 years ago to do what I'm doing now. I wasn't in a place 20 years ago to do what I'm doing now. And I had a lot of ego surrounding this stuff. Well, this is what I'm called to do. And I'm a healer. And I was in the church and I prayed for people. I was laying hands on people and I was going to different places and doing different things. And it's like, no, I was not whole enough to do this stuff. So what does whole enough mean? Circle back to relating. You circle back to relationships. You can circle back to, because there's a difference between whole. There's a difference between people who relate well and I'm reading this thing again. Whole people relate well. Well-loved people love well. There's a difference. It's not perfect whole, and there's a difference. You're whole enough to know I will always have growth and I will always be on a growth path, but I will no longer project and deflect my stuff, remaining open to converse without dodging, blame shifting, or bypassing. And that's how you know. That is how you know. I know for a fact that I, like, just because Tina's here, so she comes into the live studio, I'm going to pick on her. No, I mean, I'm picking on her. I know for a fact, and I don't have a need to do this, but I could call her up and say, can I share something with you? She would be totally open to this. Tina's not like emotionally triggered. She's not that kind of person. She's not, I might be higher strung than she is, or I don't even know if that's the way to say it, but I could call her up and talk to her about anything. And she would listen. She's going to listen. She's going to explain. She's going to say, well, this is where my mind was at the time. And she's going to break down the details. That's what healthy people do. Doesn't mean you're perfect, but it means you're whole. Whole and perfect are two different things. And whole people can handle that relationship piece because life is people. And that's what the whole thing about love is. So we've got life as people and love and dimension. And if we're going around in life as people and it's love and higher dimension, at one point we get to the love and the life as people. When we stop at the life as people part in the circle, well, what's going to happen with life as people? That there's going to be misunderstandings. There's going to be disagreements. There's going to be things that are going to happen. So how do you handle that? How you handle it? It's about how. It's all about how. And people that are really about humanity, that want to teach, that they want to do all these different modalities and the astrologies and the yogas and all the classes and the tarots and all this stuff. If you're really about humanity, you're going to be able to have these conversations. You're going to understand the nuance in between. You're going to understand the space in between. And you're going to know how to assert yourself when you need to. And you're going to know how, when to lean back when you need to. You're going to know when to speak and when not to speak. And it's all about the how, and it always will be. And I'm talking about this more because we are in this time. If I started talking about this 3 years ago, like 3 years ago, I maybe did a podcast on communication 3 years ago. People weren't ready. We're ready now because of all the upheaval that's taking place, because all this shifting that's taking place. Like this friend that wrote to me and said I was attacked out of nowhere. I'm like, welcome to the club. Hello. Like... join in. We're in good company. Like the relational stuff that's happened to me in the past 2 months is staggering. It's really. And the one particular thing that I thought did not break my heart. It really didn't. I was like, you know what? You weren't around anyway. You were never around. I'm too busy. Look, if you have somebody in your life, I don't care who it is. And this is not petty. If you have someone in your life that is a significant, important relationship, and you know what I mean by significant, important relationships, one, it falls under the spouse, and the spouse should be your divine union and your most important relationship. After that, sister, family, and then besties, best friends. And if there's an important relationship where they're constantly saying they're busy and they don't have time, busy is a choice. Okay. Busy's been a bullshit excuse for I don't know how long. It's a choice. Okay. Everybody chooses to do what they want to do all day, every day. That's the bottom line. And I don't believe in life gets in the way. I never have. And some people are probably going to drop off on me and say, you know what, Dawn? Yeah, that's just too much. Too much to say that life doesn't get in the way. It doesn't. Because we create our lives. We're conscious of our lives. We're conscious of everything we do every day. We're conscious of from the moment we wake up in the morning, take our shower, eat breakfast, and either go to work or work from home, whatever it is that we're doing. We make our everything we do all day long is a choice. We choose to be to perform on our job. We choose to eat lunch. We choose to talk to who we do. We choose to not talk to who we don't. And you choose to, let me tell you what, here's for the women. Here's for the women that women want a man in their life. I'm going to tell you, all the women that make time for all the guys that are flirting with them all over the place, but you're not making time for your best friend. Okay. What does that say? Like, you're going to make time for that. You're going to make time for a man that abuses you. I'll take it another step further. You'll make time for a man who abuses you, but you won't make time for your best friend. Think about that for a minute. And the same works in the other direction. A man will make time for a woman he's interested in, but a man won't make time for his best buddy or maybe a family member, whoever that might be. So busy is a choice. And when you value someone, you appreciate you, it's called investment. It's effort. It's effort and an investment. And you have to nurture relationship. Like, oh my gosh, I've been talking about this for 20 years. I think more than that. I mean, I was in my early 20s. I was at a church and there was this book, this little booklet, and it was called A, B, and C level relationships. It was like A, B, and C level relationship. It was just, I mean, we're talking like a long time ago, this book. And I passed it around to some friends and everybody that read this were like, oh my God, like, this is amazing. You ought to read this book. And it was this pamphlet, the little booklet thing. And people were reading it, you know, it was A level, B level, C level. If we have to break it down into levels, but they're like, and that's what I just said here. It's spouse, it's family, and then it's besties. And this particular quote, bestie, was always with the, you know, shooting me texts that were a mile long that I didn't hardly have time to read, let alone respond appropriately, because I'm not fond of texting. I'd rather just, can't we just get on the phone for maybe a half hour or something at least? Let's just do that. Surely you can make time for this. A whole litany of things. And it was eventually like, I grew used to this person not having time. You know, when you tell someone that you don't have time, it's like what you're saying is you're not important. I don't value this friendship enough. And I'm not saying you got to talk. I mean, look, we're middle-aged people. We don't talk to our friends every single week. You know, some people might talk to some people every single week. And that's great if you do. I didn't have that expectation to talk to this person every single week. Maybe every couple weeks, maybe every 3 weeks, once a month. That wasn't even happening. And so what happens is, you're on the phone for 4 hours. Like, who consider that's a half a work day. Talking on the phone for 4 hours. So eventually, you know, anyway, I'm going to move along here. There's so much I have to cover. About 53 minutes. Let's move on. Confrontation versus productive communication. Some people are scared to death of confrontation. They can't say, I hate confrontation. First of all, confrontation, and I talked about this before, is, you know, there's a difference between aggression and productive communication. So I think what people don't like is aggression. And I think that that's what they're afraid of. Productive communication are two listeners, two really good listeners, and that people know how to respond to what someone has just said. And it's just, this is just like, someone will share their heart and the other person won't even address what the first person said. They'll just go on with their own point. And did you hear what I just said? Can you respond to what I just said? Please respond to what I just said. Most people do not know how to do this. They do not know how to do this. They have conversations and I'm going to share my heart with you. And then the other person will respond in whatever react and didn't even hear what I said. I learned this so long ago that if there's a misunderstanding and you want to share your heart with someone, you want that person to hear what you just said and acknowledge they heard what you just said and speak to the points you just made before they share their points. But everybody's trying to make their point all the time. I'm going to make my points and I'm going to make my points. And then this is how arguments start. this is when people start saying, you're not hearing me. You're not hearing me. And it's like, it's not that you're not being heard. You're not being acknowledged. You're not acknowledging what I just said. Please acknowledge what I just said. Please understand my heart. Please leave your world and come into mine for a minute and understand my heart and validate what I just said. It's a whole different way of communicating. And it's necessary. It's necessary right now. So love withheld. So these are the things that happen when this doesn't happen. There's a breakdown. It's toxic. You know, people start withholding. They withhold love now. They withhold love and the intimacy becomes compromised in the friendship, in the relationship. If it's a marriage, that's not good. If family, you don't live together, like in a living together situation where you're married, hopefully if you're married, you do in fact live together. Although I do know some married couples that are married and they actually don't live together. But in any case, moving right along. So if you live together, hopefully, you know, you're able to have that conversation. Women friends have told me things that I've thought to myself, like, your husband doesn't know this? Like, how does your husband not know this? And nothing shady or weird. It's just, I could tell by what they're telling me that you guys don't talk very much, do you? I mean, I can't imagine having a husband and a life partner and a divine union. And like, I'm the type of person, I talk about everything, obviously, all of it. I mean, if I'm going through something personal, whatever, maybe not all that in every single detail, but that's the kind of person I am. I like to share everything, and it really develops emotional intimacy. It really develops that closeness and that connection, which is what leads to the hot sex, by the way. You know, and for the men out there that want to understand this, that's the key right there. And I'm not just going to say, it's not just women, because there are men that want that too, that want that emotional connection. They want that kind of, you know, that talking and that connection. But so what happens is when there isn't this productive communication, and then people start withholding love, they start drawing back, they start leaning back, and they, you know, the intimacy is compromised. And once the intimacy is compromised in the connection and the friendship, things start to kind of break down, you know, and you start going, and it's not that you don't love that person anymore. It's not that the two people don't love each other anymore. It's just there's a communication breakdown, you know, like Led Zeppelin. Communication breakdown. Okay. So it's like, people need to learn how to do this, like at a very large scale. I've been really toying with writing a book about this. Who's going to read this book? Eventually, what's going to happen is people are going to have no friends left, and they're going to be done with all the serious relationships and the third divorce and how many, God knows what else. And eventually, like, the pain might become strong enough to eventually you're going to surrender to learn how to communicate properly, especially when you're of age. I didn't include this, but age appropriate. There comes a point in time, like I said earlier about your, you know, if you're taking this stuff past your 30s. Okay. We kind of give a little grace to the 30s. You're coming out of your 20s. You're just kind of getting settled in career. Like the 30s and the early 40s is considered on paper the prime of your life, although I don't subscribe to that. I'm in the prime of my life right now, I think. But, you know, there comes a time where there's no more excuses. There's no more excuses, and there's no more anything. You've been around the block many, many times enough to know that action is necessary, that I need to do something. I need to take action. I need to make a change. I need to do something in my life to become this adequate, mature, communicative human being that can relate to people in an adequate, productive way. There just comes a time where there's just no more excuses, because I mean, what does it take? I know people that aren't even spiritual. They don't have a spiritual bone in their body. They have no idea what all this stuff that I talk about on a regular basis is, but they're very loving, conscious souls. They have great marriages with their wives and their husbands, and they don't know anything about spirituality. They know nothing. And you know what? You're all spiritual, whether you know it or not, because you know why you're spiritual? Because you are a spirit that lives in a body. You might not practice all this stuff, but you're a spirit and a soul that's living in a human fleshly meat suit on this earth, walking around. So therefore, you're on a spiritual journey. So there's that. And, you know, this isn't a spiritual show. I'm just going to say that I say this all the time. It's definitely not a religious show. It's not a spiritual show, but I do talk about spirituality because how can we not? And I never impose where you should be. I never impose what anybody needs to believe ever. I always recommend stillness. I recommend stillness, meditation, prayer, or grounding, solitude. Pick one of the five. Maybe you do all five. Pick one. You need to be still to turn the mind off, to drop down in a heart space and connect. Maybe you don't understand it. Maybe you think that there's a lot of amazing things that happen in people's meditations. And the more people, and I know different people that have different levels of this stuff. And I don't meditate every single day, but when I do, I notice that there's a change all of a sudden. There's a shift because our minds aren't always necessarily, you know, our mental head, our brain isn't necessarily aware of everything that's going on, but our soul is. And it's naturally changing the course of what we do because you're connecting, you're going inward, you're connecting. And I highly recommend the stillness, the solitude, the quiet time, the prayer. I highly recommend this wherever you're at. And it's not, you don't have to, you know, surrender your life to any religion. That's not what this is. And I say these things because there's different kinds of listeners all over the place. So the next talking point, withdrawing punishment and boundaries. Oh boy, where do I go with this? Well, I want to talk about this emotional splicing. So I'm going to skip over that for a minute. So if you're having mixed feelings with things, okay, you're having mixed feelings in a situation, in a connection with a family member, whatever it is, you know, you have mixed feelings. Wholeness is going to accept total and complete responsibility for what your participation is in something. What is emotional splicing? This hit me like a ton of bricks this morning. And I just made this up, emotional splicing. So what this is, and I want to talk about piggybacking on other people's energy. So I am going to get to that. It's only an hour and 2 minutes. So I am going to get to this. Very important because there are energy vampires. There are people that piggyback off the energy of other people and stop it. Stop it now. And these are people that have not realized their own light. And this also, I'm going to just talk about this right now. I'll get to the emotional splicing in a minute because this is very important. The people that get a form of healing, they get a form of, and it, this is also can be related to the Bible readers, that the form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. And I think what that scripture meant was you get a form of love, you get a form of it, but because the power is how you then behave and act. The power is how you move forward. The power is how you are demonstrating and presenting yourself, aligned in yourself, walking in your authority, and you are walking in that power, and it's how you demonstrate and present yourself in relationship. Relationship. You're in a relationship with your boss. You're in a relationship with your spouse, with your family members, you're in a relationship with the cashier for about a half hour, maybe 15 minutes. You're relating. How we relate. It's important. So the people that get a form of this, they get a form of healing, they get a portion of it, right? And it's like, okay, so they understand it mentally. They understand this mentally, or maybe they've embodied some of it. And so now they understand all the language and the lingo and they know what to say. And maybe there's bits and pieces that kind of come up a little bit. And so they can write really well and they want to teach and they want to do all this stuff. But really what happens is they end up sort of accumulating this cosmic debris in their energy field. I know this sounds strange. Cosmic debris in an energy field. Because you're accumulating the cosmic stuff, the mystic stuff, the loving stuff. You're accumulating this all around, but you haven't really delved deep into the light of who you are. And there's something to be said that is very significant when you have delved deep into the light of who you are, because you're very individuated. It's very embodied. You're very confident. You walk in confidence, and it's not arrogance. You have your own opinion. You have your own feelings about things. You have a truth about, you have a handle on your life. And you're not, the other stuff that I mentioned with this cosmic debris stuff is almost, it's vampirous energy where you're sucking the life out of other people. It happens in social media all day long, that people will want to become friends with all these people and all this stuff. And I'm just going to acquire what they're doing. I'm going to copy what they're doing. I'm going to mimic what they're doing. Or maybe you have some friends that are maybe a little ahead of you a little bit. And there's no such thing as being ahead. I highly disagree. Highly disagree. And there's a meme that goes, nobody's ahead of you and nobody's behind you. We're all teachers. We're all students. Okay. I would tend to think that maybe Michael Bernard Beckwith is a little more ahead of someone, an alcoholic sitting on a bar stool somewhere. I would have to say that spiritually and energetically, he might be a little more ahead of, and I'm not, there's no shame or judgment in this. I'm making a point, because these memes that go around that say, okay, everybody's in different, if we're all in different phases of consciousness, and I think the word ahead triggers people, and it triggers their insecurity is really what it is. If someone's ahead of someone, it triggers their insecurity. Like, I'll say this again. You asked for it, Tina. Tina's ahead of me in some ways. I'm not ashamed to say that. She's been doing some of this stuff since she was a kid, since she was in her 20s. She has a lot of experience under the belt. She's ahead of me in a lot of ways. She's had some stuff, experienced some stuff. Am I threatened by her? Do I have an insecurity that I'm triggered by? Absolutely not. I'm happy to learn from her in this stuff. I pick her brain sometimes. I'm like, okay, can you please help me understand this? Help me understand that. You know, I mean, shoot, get your ego and your insecurity under control enough where you're willing to say, okay, this person's ahead of me. Because think about this. There are people who teach, like the real teachers that have done the real snots in the rug work. And there are people that understand and they're really healed and whole enough to really teach people. So why do they hold seminars? And the people that show up to the seminars, they might be newbies. They're learning. So what that means that the teacher is ahead of the people that are sitting in that class. I mean, it's just silly. It's silly how some of these memes and things are just created out of insecurities and created from ego. And it really doesn't serve anybody. It's nonsense. It's nonsense. In any case, so piggybacking off other people's energy, you're sitting back and someone really is like, they have a high frequency. They're just sort of live at a high vibing space. And, you know, let's say they're doing all the talking, or they're sort of pulling the weight, so to speak, in the connection, you know, and you're just kind of coasting. You got to dig down into your own light. You have to dig down into your own light and stop just following people in social media and wanting to be friends with this and this one, and maybe having a conversation with that one so you can get a piggyback off of someone else's. Get your own daggum energy. There's so much there. It's infinite. It's infinite, the energy that you have. The energy and the love and the abundance that you have within yourself is limitless. And here's the catch. You have to move the stuff and the garbage. I don't want to say garbage, the debris, the hindrances out of the way to really get to it. And sometimes there's feeling pain involved. You have to feel into that pain. You have to feel into the pain. Not all day long. You know, it's not going to be forever. Temporary basis. Feel into the pain long enough to move that out of the way. Especially if you lack confidence. If you get nervous, every time, you know, something happens in a friendship and a connection, you just freeze, or you just become paralyzed, or you just don't know what to say. You healing. You really got to do that work. You really, really got to do that work. Men and women alike. And I keep saying this, that I'm going to do a masculine and feminine. I'm not going to say I'm going to talk about the divine masculine and the divine feminine and break it down like I did before, but maybe I'll just do a podcast surrounding the male and female dynamics and all of this. You know, I do want to say this, you know, it's like the men are the leaders of love. There's no way around that. They're the protectors. They're the hunters and gatherers. I do believe they're supposed to be the leaders of love and cover the woman and protect and provide. I this guy I just started following, and I don't know what his name is. I just started following this guy, and I don't even know how he showed up. Somehow he showed up in a newsfeed. I'm not even sure how this happened, but I found this guy. He's making no bones about what he says. He just tells it straight. He tells it straight, and he's in his late 30s, maybe, if that. And I think he's married, and he loves his woman, and he's a good looking guy, and she's a hot looking woman. And they are, you know, and he praises the daylights out of her. She's an alpha female. And he says, you know why my alpha woman submits to me? And the word submit does not mean slave, enslaved. That's not what that means at all. Because his masculine energy, he understands his masculine energy that he owns and that he walks in. And because he walks in every area of his masculine energy, it makes her feel feminine. And that's how this works. There's no way around this. I didn't make this stuff up. There are way too many people that are talking about this out there. And follow the people that are in relationships. I might not be in a relationship. I might not be married, let's say. But I understand this stuff. I absolutely understand these things. And this guy is talking to the women in particular. He's like, ladies, drop a this, that, or the other if you agree with this. I mean, he has thousands of followers. And he's basically like, you will have that strong, you know, woman in your life submit to you when you own and you stand in your divine masculine energy. And that's how it is. And so if the guys are over here going, oh, it works both ways and all this stuff, there's work yet to be done. Because this guy who's making these posts never says that. He knows who he is. He's confident in who he is, and he's not arrogant. He knows who he is. He's confident in who he is, and he stands in who he is, and he loves his woman to the ends of the earth. And he doesn't need anybody to tell him who he is. He doesn't doubt who he is, and he doesn't question. I mean, does he have areas of growth? Absolutely. And he's probably open about it. And he probably tells her about it. But she feels like an absolute divine feminine woman in his presence because she doesn't have to be in her masculine because he is. He is. So that's all I have to say about that. That's the truth of this. So piggybacking energy, it's no good. It's no good. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about, what was this next thing? Emotional splicing. The emotional splicing. I'm going to get back to that because I said that I would. Emotional splicing works like this. You have a conversation with someone and half of you knows what took place. Half of you knows what you need to take ownership in. And the other half is still blaming, is still blame shifting. You're still kind of shirking some stuff. And it's like a chip, the chip on the shoulder type thing, energetically speaking. So half of you understands what, you know, ownership. And the other half is kind of like, well, you know, but they this or they that and they this and they that. You have matured and walked into wholeness when you're not they this and that and the other. And when you're not emotionally splicing, when you've taken full ownership, let them do what they need to do. And you need to do what you need to do. And this goes back probably, I don't know, how old was I? 31 years old. When did I move to Minnesota? 1998. Yeah, this goes back a little way. So I was living in Minnesota from 1998 to 2000. Came back to New Jersey, Y2K, 2000. Out there, when I was married, we were sitting under this teacher who was talking about this, and he used to phrase it like this. He used to say, you know, stay in your own issues. You stay in your issues. The other person stays in their issues. Stay in your own issues. And that's how it was phrased back then. So I'm not saying stay in your own issues. I'm saying own your stuff. You know, own where you need growth. Own what you need to do. Be honest about it. Show up and say, hey, you know, this is what I realized. And be confident about it. I mean, this is where we're headed. This is love right here. I'm talking about the gut level love of how love and emotional intimacy shows up in connections. This is how it shows up. Because you can, you know, do the downward dog all day long on your yoga mat four times a day if you want. But if you don't know how, if you don't know how to have a conversation and you can't handle questions or you can't ask questions or you can't, you know, this is how we're, you know, I said last week, bridging the gap. This is how we're doing this. This is how we're doing this. And it's years ago, I'll say it again. Years ago, I had to suck some stuff up. Like I wasn't ready to do what I'm doing now. I needed to really just, pride's a bitch. Pride is a bitch. Pride and ego are one and the same. You know, it's like, and you don't want to just swallow your pride and then cry your eyes out and feel like a loser. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about swallow your pride into a space of freedom and liberation. Swallow your pride enough to get to the truth and allow that light to come through and say, okay, here it is. You know, accept this, feel into it, clear it, get it out of your way so we can move on now. Now you can move on into all the stuff in your life that you really want. You know, the relational situations that you want, whether it's marriage, boyfriend, girlfriend, you know, healing, restoration with a family member. You know, even like a better job, because sometimes jobs don't work out because there's conflict all day long with people. Conflict all day long with people, or just you don't like a coworker, or you just don't want. Oh my God, I have to tell you this. And The Bachelor, okay? I know this sounds really pathetic. It was on last night. It's on Monday nights. I put this show on purpose. I am not watching. I'm making this very clear, very clear. I am not watching this show because I like The Bachelor or because I think it's real at all. Not whatsoever. I'm watching this show to observe the behavior. This is largely how I've learned in life. It really is. So I watch this show, and The Bachelor's name is Joey this particular season. And if you know how this works, so Joey is dating 25 women at once or whatever the heck it is. It's really stupid. It's highly dysfunctional. It's highly toxic. And it's insane. So, but I'm watching this to observe what goes on. And I think most of it is fake. But I still want to see. You could tell what's real, though. You could tell these reactions. You can tell that there's not a lot of acting going on. And so last night's particular episode was there's this girl in the house, so to speak. That's the language. In the house, who she knows who she is. She's very confident. She's an alpha female. She's not insecure. She walks with her head held high. I forgot her name. She's a cool chick from what I could see. And I'm just watching how all the other girls in the house have been threatened by her. They've been out to get her and all this stuff. And they were out to break her. They were going to break her down. And so Joey, the Bachelor, really likes this girl among all the other girls that he likes. I just can't. I'm making a point. It's really funny. So this one girl, I forgot her name. She's not the most beautiful girl in the bunch, but you know why she is because she's confident. She's a badass and she's not really outspoken, but there had been conversations and she just speaks her mind and people are, they're triggered by her. They can't see her from a whole space. They can't see her. They are triggered by her. They're not hearing what she's saying. And she, and because of where they're at and because it's this show and because of how old they are, they're not in a conscious space enough to really communicate what's going on. They know that something's not right. So eventually last night she walked off. That he let go of the one girl. So she walked off the set. It's probably all because they intertwine. I know that they weave drama into this because this is what America wants. So they put drama into this on purpose. So this girl left. She's like in tears. She's like, I'm done with this. I can't take this anymore. I'm done. You know, and the house got what they wanted. Like they broke her and she's like, I'm tired of this. Like, I don't even understand why people don't like me. Like she doesn't understand this. Look, if you know who you are and you walk in this confidence, people are not going to like you because a lot of people don't even like themselves and they're not confident in themselves. They're going to feel threatened by the power and the authority that you walk in. They're, you know, walk in your authority and power anyway. And you know, being humble and kind. You know, do justly, love and mercy, walk humbly, okay? There's a power in that. And people don't understand this. You know, people would rather be commiserating over all this other stuff, and they, and all the women at the cooler at work would rather be bitching about how stupid men are, and all the men over here would be, you know, come to work and saying they can't stand their wives. I mean, this is low vibing garbage that, you know, that's not where we're headed though. We're headed into the deeper love, loving, amazing. That's the ascension. That's the ascension. So that's the emotional splicing, is fully own it. When you're not, you're like kind of torn in yourself between the ownership, but you're still going to fault and blame this person. And you're going to have that kind of chip on your shoulder and it's sort of an attitude-y type thing. And then sometimes some of this, you know, withholding. Now there's a difference between all this and boundaries. So I have to say this. There's a difference between withdrawing punishment and healthy boundaries. Healthy boundaries are upfront and communicated, made known. Healthy boundaries are made known to people. And I've said this to people, you know, these are my boundaries. This is where I'm at. And I'm just letting you know, this is where I am. You know, the ghosting, the withdrawing, the punishment, you know, it's like emotional punishment where you're just going to act weird and act off and act distant and indifferent and all this stuff. You got healing to do. That's the bottom line. That's on you. Whoever's, you know, if this applies, it's not the other person's fault. It doesn't matter what the other person said or did. Fully own your stuff. And then if you feel like the other person did something, talk about it. Talk about it and trust that that's what they want to hear. You know, talk about that. Be willing to be honest. Be willing to say, okay, we're going to come to the center here. We're going to come to this field of love here. We're going to come into this field. We're going to create a safe place for both parties. And we're going to have this conversation. We're going to talk this through. And we're going to establish what our boundaries are. And we're going to share, like, this is, I have to be honest with you. I felt triggered in this, and this is how I felt about this. And, you know, I feel like I have growth to do in the confidence department, or I feel I have, you know, some insecurities left hanging I need to really deal with. But everybody's afraid to do this because they'd rather have an image. They want this multidimensional, ascended, astral, confident, tarot, astrology, singing bowl, circle, this leadership teaching image. But in the meantime, can't have a conversation behind the scenes, which is what this friend told me. She said, they don't want to talk. They said to this person, whoever it is, you know, and they said, they basically, can we just move on from this? And I told her, I said, anytime someone says, can we just move on? Do we have to go through this? Can you just let it go? That's narcissism. That's narcissism. It doesn't make someone a narcissist, but it's narcissism when they gaslight and they put it on you that you can't move on. Do you have to talk about this? Why are you acting like this? You know, this kind of stuff. And they make you out to be two, this, that, and the other. No, that's called gaslighting. And it's a version of narcissism. Narcissism is driven by fear. It's not grounded in love at all. Because love's going to show up. It's going to be honest. It's going to be open. It's going to be vulnerable. And that's what it's going to do. And it's going to establish the boundaries. That's the healthy boundaries is what's going to happen. And you can develop that mutual understanding, the mutual understanding as a result of a healthy conversation and establishing healthy boundaries. Okay, going forward. So here's a boundary. Like suppose, I don't know, pick somebody, a spouse, a family member, a friend, a boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever it is. Someone, you know, is going through something and they're silent and the other person is experiencing it as, you know, distant, off or something or other. Communicate that. Say, hey, Jeff Brown has talked about this too. Jeff Brown wrote about this. Oh, I don't know. In one of his books before Grounded Spirituality came out in 2019 or 20. So this goes back a while and it's in a meme of his. You know, and I don't know what meme it is, but I love Jeff Brown. So he's talked about this, where instead of, you know, just disappearing for a while and saying, you know, hey, I need some time, or I'm going through something and it's not personal and I value our friendship, I value our connection, I value our marriage. I just need some time. I don't want to talk about this for a while. Or, you know, I'm going to need some time to figure some stuff out. And it's not that I don't love you. And it's not that I don't, you know, just don't take it personal. Because everybody's human. And everybody has the potential to, when you have opened your heart to someone and there's a vulnerability involved in that and the emotional intimacy. And when there is that connection and someone just drops out, like, there's this evident, you know, something's different, just communicate it. The person on the receiving end, the man, the woman, family, whatever it is, on the receiving end will so value that and appreciate that. Thank you for letting me know. And you know what? I wish you well in your process. Take all the time you need. I wish you well in your process. I wish for you. I hold good space for you. I want you to get through this. I want you to figure this out. And if there's anything I can maybe offer to help you figure it out, I'll do that too. Why is this so hard? You know, so that all being said, hour and 25 minutes. Let me see here. The energy you have and demonstrate and so much more. It's always about the energy that you house. Okay. So the thing, the relational situations that you're experiencing in this moment, if you've taken all the responsibility for all the relationships and friendships that you have in this moment, and you've done your best to communicate, then it's up to the other person to do their part. If you haven't, then there's adjustments that need to be made perhaps, and then you can just maybe make some adjustments. And, you know, and everybody's in different phases of this. I mean, maybe it's been hard for you to do something like this. Maybe you've never felt safe within your own self to reach out to someone and say, you know, this is what I'm experiencing. That's the risk. That's the step, you know, the step of faith, so to speak, or that's the growth. The growth spurt is happening in that. When you face that insecurity, you face that fear, and you step out in it. That's how you break it. It's not broken in the yoga mat, in the meditation. Good things happen in that. Or, you know, somebody laying hands on you, or, you know, dropping cards. Take the action. The action step, that's how we break patterns. We break patterns and cycles by taking action. By taking action and doing something. It's like, before you know, oh, was it that bad? Now you can do it again. And again, and again, and again, and again. And then you can do it. And I'm telling you, it is hard. This is hard for you to probably be hard for anybody to believe. I was a pushover like the day is long, like years ago. I was this person back in my 20s and early 30s where I, you know, if I thought, I was the one that always made the phone call or sent the email. Are you mad at me? I feel like you're mad at me. And I knew they weren't mad at me. And that we used to do this in high school. Are you mad at me? And what you were really trying to say is, I feel a distance. I feel something has changed. And let me take the responsibility on myself, because I don't want to ask them why they've changed. So let me put it on me. Let me self-blame. And that's really what that is. Adults are still doing this. Are you mad at me? Did I do something wrong? You know you didn't do something wrong. You know that there's no reason for somebody to be mad at you. But it's easier to self-blame, to take them off the hook. And guess what? You're enabling their issue. By putting it on you, you're enabling their issue. Instead of saying, I'm feeling doesn't seem right. Would you please tell me what's going on? Don't blame yourself. Don't get into self-blame, because you're just putting yourself in, oh my God, like I broke that. Years ago, I broke that. And that's exactly how I used to be. And hearing me talk now, that's a true story. That is a true story that I used to do that. I did it through high school. I did it through, you know, I was a pushover and I was a doormat. Like, you have no idea. And I broke that, the back of that stuff, you know, walking in my power, owning my power, walking in my authority. Everybody's supposed to do this. You're all supposed to do this. And we're all supposed to have honest conversation. Don't take on the burden that doesn't belong to you. And then don't put burden upon others that doesn't belong to them. Because we're all amazing, magical beings with this ability and this infinite power and this love within us that we can break away from the codependency and all of the sludge that we were raised in, you know, and that's owning your light. That's walking in the power of your light. And this is how we help each other heal. You know, this is how we do it. So this is how we do it. Okay. That being said, I'm going to stop right there. I hope you got something out of this. I really enjoyed this. It's an hour and 29 minutes. Thank you, Tina, for showing up. I appreciate you being here. And Carrie and Dave, as always, I love you guys. And I'm going to be back on Thursday, like I said. And so my name is Dawn Shale. You can find me at www.dawnshale.com. You can learn more there about how I coach and counsel clients. This podcast will be listed in the podcast tab on my website, as well as iHeartRadio, Spotify, Amazon Music, and YouTube. Do subscribe to my YouTube channel. It will be uploaded there, and it's easier. The easiest places to go would probably be my website to push play, and also YouTube to go over there and just find a podcast and push play. Probably the two best sources to find this. If you feel this would benefit anybody you know, such as friends, family, or coworkers, send them the link to this show. Sharing is caring, as always. And let them know who I am, and then they can experience this, and perhaps it will help them in some way. And also, the thing is about this podcast, I can only serve you so much here, but I can do way more substantially one-on-one. I'm available to give more. There are different levels that I work with people. If you or anybody you know is looking for answers right now for their own life, I'd love to talk to you. I'd love to get to know you or them better through a complimentary intuitive call. You're welcome, guys. Take note of what I just said. Feel free to share as you feel led, and I always appreciate when people do that, and it's never expected. Like I said, I will be back on Thursday. David Medansky is going to be my special guest, and what we're talking about, I'm not exactly sure. You'll have to tune in to find out. In the meantime, have an amazing rest of your week. Live loved, live blessed. Walk in your power, own your authority, and I will talk at you soon. See you then. Take care. Bye-bye.
I was a lonely soul, but that's the only. A little wiser now, from what you showed me.